Like Professor Rinkema said, I'm going to be talking to you guys today about dialects of YouTube, what we're trying to understand online speech communities. So when we think about language and the internet, one of the most common conclusions that we usually jump to is the idea that the internet is changing how we communicate in fundamental ways. And sometimes it's easy to think of those changes as inherently negative. We think of the use of common acronyms and abbreviations, so with LOL, OMG, legitimate is actually a recent one. And a lot of English speakers kind of question whether or not these changes are good, bad, or just a natural part of a living language that is bound to change and evolve over time. But while language change is of linguistic and cultural importance, there's actually something else that language and the internet share, and that's connection. We use language to connect with the people around us, and the internet is just another outlet through which we are learning to navigate, express our thoughts and our ideas, and form and maintain communities. So when we think of offline communities, I think we would all be able to say we don't just belong to one group or community. We have our friends, we have our family, there's work, we have school and church and things like that. Sometimes these will overlap a little bit, but it's not even possible to really be a member of one specific community and not any other. The idea is the same for online communities. Users online are usually a part of multiple online communities. Some of the bigger players are going to be Tumblr, YouTube, Twitter, these different things. And how we communicate in those settings is going to be different depending on the site and the communities on them. And so in the way that members of regional communities that are geographically based, such as either Midwestern America or Boston, Massachusetts, exhibit distinct accents or dialects, could we argue that members of certain online communities exhibit internet dialects? The research on this question is kind of limited, but I'm willing to argue that there are internet dialects and that these communities are built around their own systems of beliefs, ideas, values, and concepts of reality and identity that are reflected in the way that they use language together. So for the purpose of this presentation, before we go much further, I want to take some time quickly discussing the difference between an accent and a dialect. Because most, if not all, internet-based communities rely on text as the main mode of communication, any distinct use of language in these communities cannot be considered an accent. Accents are determined by pronunciation, the way a language sounds, and they're usually based in geographic location. So we think of, you know, somebody who is from New York is going to sound a lot different than somebody who's from Dallas, Texas. And so Mike Rungetta in his video on YouTube, Are There Internet Dialects, on the PBS Idea channel, discusses the difference between accents and dialects, and he explains how speakers of a language can easily identify a dialect of a certain group of people in a specific geographic location. And then he asks, how then are we able to identify where a certain part of the internet somebody is from by the way they use language online? So trying to kind of understand dialect a little bit more, Rungetta took a lot of time discussing this, and he says that dialect kind of, members of certain online communities might speak in different accents offline, but the way that they utilize language together online will usually follow some sort of pattern that reflects their identity as a community, resulting in a distinct dialect for that community. So going with the idea of being able to identify dialects offline and asking if we're able to recognize where somebody is from on the internet, the reason that we are usually able to recognize what kind of part of the internet somebody is from is based on something that what Emily Eckert refers to as communities of practice. And Rungetta explains this as, Rungetta introduces this idea by saying that, in short, what you do, who you do it with, how you talk about it, how the talking advertises or supports the doing, and how you self-identify as a doer of those things are all very intimately linked. And the dialect that a certain community online is characterized by will reflect these things. So again, being able to, when we're thinking about particularly American English, we're able to recognize where somebody is from based on how they sound. So for various reasons, then there has emerged what linguists refer to as standard American English. And that is gonna be the language and the dialect that you see in the media. It's the version of American dialect that is taught within business and education. And so Rungetta suggests then that there might also be a standard of general American internet dialect. He argues that this general American internet dialect is characterized by various words and expectations that most internet users must be familiar with in order to effectively communicate in an online setting. He says that they are marked by the use of common acronyms. We're going to cover LOL, OMG, YOLO. Please tell me that you guys have used YOLO and, like, okay, good, we're good on that? Okay. And also the use of most recognized emoticons. He also suggests they might be marked by occasionally the nervously deployed hashtag. It also comes along with this kind of general American internet dialect, the ability to understand memes, which combine image and text to display emotion, comments, or experiences. I found that the Cruzy meme on a Facebook page that was created about 2012. It was Hyper College Memes. It's long dead, but I found that buried in there and made me really happy. But so without having a general understanding of these basic components of a general American internet dialect, individuals might struggle to understand a lot of online discourse, which is why it's so important to be able to understand these things before they can become members of more specialized online communities. So in addition to the terms and expectations of online English, many larger websites will also carry with them a set of general terms and expectations that are unique to their own platform. Usually these are going to be with technical terms that you need to be able to understand that community's overarching expectations and community guidelines. So on YouTube you have the technical terms of subscription box, annotation, just kind of technical terms that explain how the site itself functions. But the interesting thing is you also see a lot of community terms within specific online communities. One of those is referring to community members, so especially ones that encourage community building around shared interests. On Tumblr, a member of a larger community is called a Tumblrite, and then a Tumblrhood is a group of Tumblrites who interact with each other on a regular basis, which I thought was really awesome. I don't understand it, but it's cool. On YouTube, then, the people that create the videos are called creators, partners, and actually more recently, YouTubers. And both Tumblr and YouTube in these instances are doing something called back formation. What they're doing is they're taking the name of that website and they're going back and turning it from just the name of a site into somebody who does YouTube. By adding that R, they become a YouTuber. Similarly, we are all, most of us I'm guessing, are from Michigan and we are Michiganders. So by adding that R at the end of YouTube kind of suggests that somebody who is a YouTuber is not just somebody who uses a website, but there's a part of a larger community that is very complex and meaningful, and part of their identity then is kind of derived from that membership and that name given to them. So when I was looking at a couple handfuls of the communities on YouTube, it was kind of hard to neatly define or even determine if these communities have what can be classified as their own dialect. Part of the issue with this is that YouTube understands communication, and more specifically discourse, in fundamentally different ways than most online communities that are primarily text-based, because the very nature of the site, a video sharing platform, is that the conversation begins with a video. Benjamin Cook, in one of his YouTube documentary series, Becoming YouTube, talks about this in saying that it's very easy to say, okay, so YouTube has videos, then is YouTube a new television? Is it replacing television, or is it the same thing as television? And he actually says, no, this is a fallacy to equate YouTube to TV. He says that, quote, the delivery mechanism is changing. Many of us watch TV or listen to radio on our computers now, but the on-demand, user-generated nature of videos on YouTube makes it a complementary medium to TV, not its rival. He takes his argument further, though, saying that YouTube is at its best when it does stuff that TV can't, when it experiments with form and content, when it remembers that TV is a monologue and YouTube is a conversation. And when we're thinking about dialects and speech communities on YouTube, it's so important to understand that conversation of the way that YouTube it's not just one person talking, it's an ongoing cycle of conversation, even if it is a little bit more complex than you and I just sitting here and talking. So in its most basic form, YouTube embodies, through this ongoing conversation between creators and viewers, a cycle begins with somebody uploading a video. So before I get into this, how many of you guys actively participate on YouTube? Got a couple? Okay. All right, so for you guys that don't really, it's kind of hard to understand it as an outsider of that community, but I'm going to try my best. So what it starts with is somebody uploads a video, and then from there, it moves to their community, the people that are watching these videos, and they engage in this conversation. They respond in a number of different ways. They can like or dislike a video. They can comment on it. They can share it with their friends, and they can subscribe to that specific channel so they can continue to engage in that ongoing conversation with that creator. And from there, the conversation moves back to the YouTuber, the creator, who gets to decide how to engage with that conversation and how the viewers are responding. They can then reply to the comments in the comment section. They can actually call out those comments and respond to them verbally in their next video. They can do Q&A videos. And with this next video comes more response, and the cycle just kind of keeps repeating itself. So, like I mentioned earlier, this is a really new area of study, and more in-depth analysis definitely needs to happen. But for the purpose of this presentation, I took a little bit of time looking at two specific communities. And I wanted to look and see if, by looking at these, if they result in some sort of shared interest or dialect. And looking at these communities, it's important to note that I wasn't looking for necessarily spelling or word choices, though they do play a role in dialect, but instead attempted to utilize something called critical discourse analysis, which rests in the idea that ways of talking create, maintain, and reinforce ways of thinking. The reason for that is that, as stated earlier, members of online communities can come from multiple regional, political, social, and educational backgrounds. So the way that they utilize language on the surface may vary greatly, depending on the size and nature of the community itself. However, this doesn't mean that there can be no connection in the way that they communicate and use language online together. So the first case study that I did was on Shay Carl. Anybody know who that is? You do? Good. Wow, that's the first person I found that knows him. Shay has a vlogging channel, and I'm going to play you guys a quick intro clip to him and his family. It's 44 seconds, so it's not too bad.
What does she do? The what?
All right. Let's probably notice right off the bat is that his community name is Shay Carl and the Shay Cards, which if you are outside of that community, that's kind of offensive. Part of speech communities and knowing of dialect or dialects, communities of practice, is having a shared experience. And so people within this community understand where that name came from. It came from one of the first videos that Shay uploaded, in which he was in his living room wearing his wife's unitard, dancing around to get his buddies to laugh, which earned him the nickname Shaytard. And then about 2 years later, somehow turned into the name of anybody who is behind this family. So you are a Shaytard if you follow and support this family. Another thing that I found interesting when I was looking at not only the way that Shay and his family talk and how they use language in their videos, but the comments, Shay frequently talks about, and he says all the time, that happiness is a choice. He wants his channel to be a positive outlet for him and his family to share with other people that we have the ability to not just focus on the negative all the time. And that's not making light of things and kind of ignoring the serious, but he's a big proponent of joy and finding happiness and meaning within our lives. And I was wondering if that kind of idea and value would reflect in the comment section. Because I don't know about you guys, but most comment sections online are a little bit scary, and nobody wants to go there ever. But in the video, on Shay's videos in the comment section, there is going to be that negativity, especially because he does have a larger community. But there was a surprisingly large amount of positive comments. Words like smile, laugh, family, thank you, all kinds of positive messages were just flooding through these comment sections, and it was so cool to see that the way that Shay and his family kind of conduct their lives and this positivity was reflected in the way that their community communicated together. Sometimes the language and the words are not denotatively positive or negative, but the tone used to get the message across is usually light, a lot more positive than a lot of other communities online, which I thought was really interesting to see that. So the language that Shay uses lends to the fact that he does value positivity, family, life, and relationships, and these ideas are definitely reflected strongly in the comments and the way that his community engages together. So the second community that I looked at is the Apprentice A video team, led by Corey Vidal. I'm gonna also show you guys a video for that. This one's a little bit longer, but we're only gonna watch part of it.
We are not in Canada right now. What a weird place to start a new channel. The Dream Team, Apprentice A. I've got my memory always inside me, but I can't go back to how it was. We got a house, and we're moving.
Someone say Switchfoot. Okay, good. I thought when they put up this video, they actually put it up after I did my original paper for this, and the fact that they used that song I thought was really interesting because the chorus says, "This is home, this is finally where I belong." And that is something that is so important to Corey Vidal, who is the main person on this channel. He kind of grew up in an area where in his immediate location, he didn't feel like he belonged. He felt like he was misunderstood, and he found in YouTube a community where he did feel like he belonged. And the cool thing about that is when I was looking at kind of the what they talk about, how they use language, one thing that was really interesting was not necessarily the words they were saying and the topics they were talking about, but how they pieced those together through their editing technique. And one common thing on YouTube and a lot of online kind of like video platforms is to cut out the vocal pauses, to make it look like the way they are speaking is very well put together and easier to understand. And for Corey and for his friends, it's very important and kind of a part of them to feel like I can put out what I want to say and I don't have to say it two or three times. People get it the first time because of the way we are editing. And when I was looking at that, I thought it was really interesting just to see how just the way they edited, even though it wasn't what they were saying, reflected what they valued. Another important element in the Apprentice A discourse is education. It's not talked about as often within their videos, though there have been several discussions about education, reading, and I wanted to ask, does this reflect the type of people that are in their community? I jumped to the comments to see if it did, and this might be stretching the interpretation a little bit, but I'm inclined to argue that it does. The comments in this community, especially compared to Shay's community, take far more care with spelling and grammar. And the things that they talk about are more complex and kind of grown up. But why is this, though, if Corey and his friends are significantly younger than Shay and his wife? There's a couple things that I thought about when I was looking at this. And it's probably not all-inclusive, but there are a few things that might suggest why this is. First of all, Corey's in the Apprentice A channel is a lot smaller. Shay has a much larger following on YouTube, so he's more likely to draw in people that are outside of his age range. More commonly, the average YouTube user who is between kind of middle and high school age. So that kind of explains why the subject matter might be a little bit more immature, there's more spelling errors, things like that. And a lot of the people for Shay's channel watch because they're attracted to the idea of a happy and healthy family. They frequently express that they see Shay and his wife as a mom and dad figure, especially for kids that say, hey, I don't have a good situation going on at home, but I can see this happy family, and it makes me happy that I might be able to give that to my family when I grow up. So it makes sense that they would have that younger demographic in their comments. And finally, like I said, Corey and the Apprentice A team, their community is so much smaller. They haven't reached a popularity that has brought in that typical YouTube demographic yet. Instead, the people that typically watch the Apprentice A videos are doing so because of their shared interest in YouTube, community, literature, film production, Star Wars even, and they're possibly drawn to the idea, or drawn to the image of somebody who is 20-something years old, who is educated, who is in constant search of more knowledge, they're curious, and they're passionate about making a career out of something that they love to do. And these values are all reflected in the language of both the blog and the comments in this community. The internet and the communities that are built within it are very complex and they're constantly changing, but so are the individual members that make these communities possible. So even though the way that the Shaytards and the Apprentice A communities use language might be defined one way today, the way that their community languages are defined in a year or two could probably be a lot different. This doesn't mean, though, that we can't that we can completely rule out the possibility that these communities do, in fact, share an internet dialect. Language and the people that use it are constantly changing, and more importantly, dialect is so much more than how we speak or how we even type, but it is instead built on a very distinct set of goals, practices, beliefs, and concepts of reality that communities of practice share. The communities within YouTube, as well as the other communities online, are consistently illustrating that communities do not need to be anchored in a geographic location to find meaning and a sense of identity. And the language they use together to facilitate these connections reflects the things they do and value together, suggesting that they do in fact embody some form of an internet dialect, as messy and complex as they are.